Hi, I'm Macaque who loves history. Imagine two rising powers in the ancient world, Greece, the cradle of philosophy and art, and Rome, a growing force with an unquenchable thirst for conquest. Both civilizations were on a collision course. But what made them so different, and why were they destined to clash?
Let's start with Greece. A civilization that flourished on intellectual prowess and artistic expression. Cities like Athens became the birthplace of democracy, where thinkers like Socrates and Plato shaped the very concept of philosophy. Contrast this with Rome, a society grounded in military discipline, expansion, and law. Rome wasn't just interested in ideas, it was interested in power. The question we must ask ourselves is, how did these two civilizations, so culturally different, find themselves on a path toward inevitable conflict? Before the swords clashed, there were diplomatic exchanges. Rome and Greece, at first, were cautious allies, bound by convenience rather than trust. But what happens when two growing empires try to share the same space? Is peaceful coexistence even possible? Rome respected Greek art and culture, yet their ambitions stretched far beyond admiration. While Greece sought to maintain its intellectual influence, Rome's legions were already marching eastward, with their eyes set on more than just admiration, they wanted control. This early diplomatic dance was just a prelude. But the question lingers, how long can two giants share the same stage before they collide? As history shows, Rome's rise to power was unstoppable. The Greek city-states, though intellectually unmatched, were politically fractured. Meanwhile, Rome's military grew stronger, more organized, like a machine built for dominance. Was Greece ever in a position to resist Rome? Or was the conquest inevitable from the start? The more we explore their contrasting strengths, the clearer it becomes Rome's hunger for control couldn't be satisfied with diplomacy alone. They needed to conquer. The Macedonian Wars. It was here that Rome took its first real steps into Greek territory. But why target Macedonia? Rome was strategic. Macedon was the gateway to the rest of Greece. If Rome could topple this powerhouse, it would send a message to the entire Hellenic world. Think of the Macedonian army as a phalanx, a wall of spears, impenetrable. But Rome's legions, flexible and fast, adapted to the battlefield like no other. Could Macedonia's seemingly unbeatable tactics withstand Rome's unrelenting force? That's the question we face as we dive into the First Macedonian War. After a tenuous peace, the Second Macedonian War erupted. But this time, Rome was no longer content with strategic moves, they wanted dominance. Philip V of Macedon had to know this was more than a territorial dispute. It was a battle for supremacy. The Roman legions moved with precision, while Macedon's forces relied on the traditional phalanx formation. But the battlefield had changed. Rome's flexibility outmatched Macedon's rigid structure. Imagine a powerful but slow-moving wall going against a fast, disciplined machine. The result? Rome's growing power could not be denied. Philip V's defeat was more than just a military loss. It was the moment when Greece began to realize that Rome wasn't just another enemy. They were the new masters of the Mediterranean. How did Rome manage to weaken such a powerful kingdom? The answer lies not just in their military tactics, but in their political strategy. Rome didn't just defeat Macedonia on the battlefield, they divided and conquered Greece, one city-state at a time. What did this mean for the future of Greece? Was there any hope left for resistance? Now, the Third Macedonian War. This wasn't just a battle, it was a clash of titans. Rome, now a dominant force, was ready to crush all who opposed them. Perseus of Macedon, the last hope of Greek independence, faced them on the battlefield. Imagine the scene, the Roman legions, disciplined and swift, clashing against the formidable Macedonian phalanx. Who would emerge victorious? By now, Rome had mastered the art of war. They understood how to break through even the most resilient defenses. The question remains: could Greece still hold on to its freedom, or was the end inevitable? The Battle of Pydna. This was where Rome delivered the final blow. The Macedonian phalanx, once considered impenetrable, was shattered. Rome's tactical brilliance and sheer discipline proved too much for the Greek forces. Picture this, the once mighty Macedonian army crumbling under the relentless pressure of the Roman legions. The fall of Macedon marked the end of Greek independence. From this point on, Rome ruled the Hellenistic world. How did such an unstoppable force like the phalanx fail? The answer lies in Rome's superior adaptability and strategic genius. But Greece wasn't done yet. The Achaean War was one last attempt at resistance. The Greeks, proud and desperate, rose up against their Roman oppressors. Could this be the moment where Greece finally regained its independence? The city of Corinth, once a symbol of Greek culture and strength, fell in 146 BC. Imagine a once thriving metropolis reduced to ruins. Rome's message was clear: resistance was futile. The burning of Corinth was not just the end of the war, it was the end of an era. Was there any hope left for Greece after this devastation? And yet, despite the destruction, something remarkable happened. The Roman Empire, though it conquered Greece militarily, was itself conquered culturally. Greek philosophy, art, and science became the foundation of Roman civilization. How did the conquerors end up adopting the culture of the conquered? That is the paradox of history. Rome may have defeated Greece on the battlefield, but Greek culture lived on, shaping the very empire that sought to destroy it. The legacy of this conquest is a fascinating one. Rome didn't just take territory, they absorbed an entire civilization. Greek philosophy, art, and architecture became integral to Roman society. Can you imagine the Roman Empire without its Greek influences? What would Western civilization look like today without the blend of these two great cultures? The long-term impact of Rome's conquest of Greece goes beyond the ancient world. This fusion of cultures laid the foundation for much of what we now consider Western civilization. From law to art, from philosophy to science, the Roman-Greek legacy is all around us.
That's all for today's story. Don't forget to subscribe, hit the like button, and leave a comment. We're looking forward to hearing from you.